Well, good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mrs. Chairman, too. Ladies and gentlemen, talking about metabolic neuropathy, it's a term which includes a broad spectrum of metabolic disease out of the systemic illness, which can cause damage to the nerve itself, the nerve fiber itself. And simply to differentiate between this kind of metabolic neuropathy and the other neurogenic pain, let us imagine a patient comes to our clinic with sciatica or brachialgia, and when we investigate him, we found that there is a disc that compromised the nerve root, I mean it compressing it. But this is not the state in that kind of metabolic neuropathy you are talking about, because the damage inside the nerve itself. In the first case, when we decompress the nerve, when we remove the disc, the nerve will subside. But in these cases, mostly the pain is felt inside the nerve root itself. And to visualize that, I would say that the common hallmark in this kind of metabolic neuropathy is alteration of the structure and or function of myelin and axons of the peripheral nerve. And when you look at the anatomy of the nerves, we have the rod of Ranvier, we have the myelin sheath and the axon inside. So the affection either to the myelin sheath itself or to the axons, and of course these depend on the severity of the disease. I think most of us remember these words when we talk about neuropathy, peripheral neuropathy in general, dank the rebist. Even the metabolic neuropathy included inside this, but to memorize that, the diabetes mellitus are there, alcohol, nutritional, Guillain-Barré, traumatic, and so. But what we are in concern this morning about, in fact, is the disease that caused the metabolic neuropathy only. And of course, on top of the list is the diabetes mellitus. It's the commonest cause of peripheral neuropathy. And let us imagine that in 70% of patients with diabetes who are suffering from the disease for more than 25 years, in 70% of those patients, there is a significant neuropathic pain. It's not a small figure. It's actually very significant and large one. The second on top of the list is the uremia, where we have a cases of chronic renal failure. It does affect the nerves, the nerve fiber in general, and it does cause a kind of metabolic neuropathic disorder. Uremia, in fact, comes like subacute state, not like in diabetes on the long, long run. But we have to remember also, in patients with chronic renal failure, there is a big entity of those patients who are suffering originally from diabetes. Otherwise, they will not end by advanced diabetic nephropathy and subsequently with chronic renal failure. Other causes might be the hypoglycemia, the hypothyroidism, the hepatic failure, whether it is due to alcohol or something else, polycythemia, amyloidosis, and porphyry. And sometimes I'm talking about a rare disease, and you have a patient with neuropathy, and you have the symptoms. It's very clear that this is a neuropathic pain, and we don't know what is the diagnosis. And then we discover that it's a very rare entity like porphyry. So we have to consider porphyry in the mind. Of course, the nutritional, like deficiency of the vitamins, vitamin B1, B6, and B12, this is the commonest. Well, what about the topographic involvement? The commonest in these cases, what we always met is a polyneuropathy. You have it like a mixed sensory neuropathy, sensory motor neuropathy, and autonomic. It's very important in entity, and the prognosis with this one particularly is of utmost importance, and we hear to Dr. Christian when he did talk about erectile dysfunction. Yes, it is started in the hypothalamus, but it ends by the parasympathetic that caused this affection, and it is there in the diabetes. Other things, and I think Dr. Adil Zaki was going to talk about this in his presentation, the diabetic heart disease and how the autonomic affection can lead to arrhythmia, can lead to orthostatic hypotension, can lead to cardiomyopathy with its subsequent, and at the end what is called silent angina that can end by death. So autonomic neuropathy, in fact, is very important. We will never ever underestimate it. Other forms, either focal or multifocal neuropathies, of course, it can come in the lower limb, it can come in the upper limb, it can come in one side or the other. Or at the end, it might be mixed forms. You have everything. And by the way, there are some disease where we're always talking about that there is no rules. In general, one of them is metabolic neuropathy. You don't find the correlations, not like in other neurogenic pain when you have a dermatomal distribution and you say, yes, this is because that nerve is affected. It's not the state in metabolic neuropathy. How it starts? Usually in the lower limbs, usually. And usually start at the distal parts. So when a patient comes with burning pain coming from the toes and gradually extend up to the leg, then the thigh, or the lower half of the thigh, this is typical description of a kind of peripheral neuropathy. When we have it with the upper limbs, everybody remember glove and Stokes, and it may involve anterior abdominal wall. And I think in internal medicine, you might meet a cases with truncal pain or abdominal pain, and we don't know what is the reason. Sometimes the metabolic neuropathy is the reason. And I would say, in few cases, we might underestimate it or we might underdiagnose it. How would the patient feel? Burning pain is the main symptom in these cases. And to make it classical, it typically gets worse at the night. And by this, we can even differentiate it from other kind of pain. Pins and needles might happen. Lancinating, paresthesia, which is shooting like electrical pain. And also, entrapment in neuropathy can happen with this metabolic neuropathy. How? In hypothyroidism, for example, or in chronic renal failure, it aggravates the condition where you have a deposition of whatever in the soft tissue that causes more and more pressure. So we can have carpal tunnel syndrome, or we have tarsal tunnel syndrome in these cases. So when we have a patient with chronic renal failure or patient with hypothyroidism, we should consider carpal tunnel syndrome, tarsal tunnel syndrome, in different kind of pain, whether in the hand or in the foot. Motor neuropathy, asymmetrical or asymmetrical weakness, yes, we can see that. We will never forget about the cranial neuropathy. It's very important. The third nerve palsy, one of the commonest manifestations of the cranial neuropathy with diabetes. Also, the optic nerve can be affected, and you might find a retinal starting from the exudate edema hemorrhage. But the nerve fibers is also affected to some extent and subsequently affecting the field of vision. And that's why when you have a patient with diabetic disease, we have to search everywhere, starting from the eye down to the foot, which is actually beneficial, and you will find sign there. Facial dropping because of the facial nerve, and lacrimation, facial pain, trigeminal, all of these are a kind of cranial neuropathy that can happen with those people who are presented with metabolic neuropathic disorder. Well, again, in few of the disease, we don't have a sharp lines to differentiate between state and state. We don't have a sharp line to say this is the stage where the disease is mild or a moderate or severe. This actually happened here in metabolic neuropathy. And that's why they brought a kind of clinical grading talking about it's possible or probable or definitive diagnosis. Possible diagnosis, when the patient comes to you and tells you the history, he tells you the story typical, the one of the peripheral neuropathy. He will say, I have the burning pain at night, more and more, I have pins and needles. That's very good. When we examined the patient, we didn't find sign. We didn't find absent ankle reflex. We didn't find hypothesia or hypoalgesia. At this moment, we will say this is a possible diagnosis of metabolic neuropathy. In the second group, when we are talking about the probable, he might have not the typical history, but on examination, you will find this neurological finding. We will find absent ankle reflex. We will find hypalgesia or hypothesia. So we say this is probable. When we have both of them together, the typical history as well as the examination, this is definitely a definitive diagnosis of metabolic neuropathy. Why I'm stressing on this? Because I would say the most important this subject that a lot of cases are underdiagnosed. And when it comes to the treatment, we will see that also some of the cases might not get the proper treatment because, by the way, of the deficiency of the diagnosis. So history, clinical examination, and supporting lab investigation are very important in diagnosis of cases of metabolic neuropathy. And as I said it's a suggestive diagnosis because, yes, it is still, unless in very few cases we take a nerve biopsy and we say, well, this is a metabolic neuropathy. What about the treatment? The best medical care, of course, this is logic. The best medical care for those patients with metabolic neuropathy is to control the underlying process. You have a diabetic patient, we have to control the blood sugar. We have a patient with chronic renal failure, we have to control the urea and creatinine. It's so and so, because this will give you even better prognosis after the therapy. And I'll not talk too much about the treatment because I know this is beyond the scope of the short presentation. But what I want to say is that in these cases of metabolic neuropathy, there is a first line of treatment, which I think a lot of us or few of us missed it sometimes. When we treat patient with diabetic neuropathy or patient with metabolic neuropathy, we should start by the first line treatment. We should start by the pregabalin, gabapentin, and tricyclic, because this is more efficient in this kind of pain rather than the other analgesia. And not only that, but also the dose. I intentionally put the dose for the pregabalin because we know that sometimes you put an underdose for those cases. So 75 milligram twice daily, that you can increase it by 150 every 3 to 7 days, depending, of course, on the response. And the maximum will be 300 twice daily. And actually, this is the capsule of the pregabalin and how the pellets looks. And I'll not go through pharmacological actions, but pregabalin, as well as the gabapentin, both of them reduce the substance B and the calcitonin gene-mediated peptide. And by these two maneuver, they reduce the pain to some extent, although this is not understood how it comes. Both of them, pregabalin and gabapentin, are basically anticonvulsant medications. They have an anxiolytic effect, and at the same time, they are analgesic. And I'm always emphasized on both of them at the first line in neuropathic pain. Tricyclic antidepressant is very well known to the psychiatry. Sometimes we have to go for topical lidocaine or gel to soothe the area where there is a severe pain. Second line of treatment, selective serotonin, norepinephrine, reuptake inhibitors. It comes after the first line, and then the tramadol. Somebody will ask about the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. There is a rule for everything. You can use anything. But the point that go first to the first line of treatment, and then after that, we can try the other medication. As we hear from Dr. Arinata, we want to move our patients. So actually, we want to move our patient here also. Modified and controlled diet is helpful. We just mentioned that about the logic and treatment of the underlying pathology. And mostly, no restriction in activity are recommended, unless Dr. Adel said he's a cardiac patient, we will not move him for some reasons. Is there a rule for surgery in cases with metabolic neuropathic pain? Yes, there is. Yes, it's not so common, but in some cases, as I mentioned about the entrapment neuropathy that is associated with an advanced form of metabolic neuropathy, we have to go for decompression. But in the same time, we will tell our patient that this is not a classic case of carpal tunnel syndrome, for instance, and the prognosis will not be like the prognosis in the other cases. This is the last slide, and as I mentioned about the control of primary metabolic condition is very important, and I will mention about the worst prognosis than other neuropathy when we have an autonomic, and I clarified why. But I would say the take-home message from here, it's only in two things. we have to be careful. Metabolic neuropathy is underdiagnosed and at the same time under treatment, whether regarding the type of the drugs or the dose of this medication. And thank you.